Hello and welcome to Capital Conversations. This is NET News weekly discussion with policymakers whose decisions affect Nebraskans' lives. With me today is Senator Steve Lathrop from Omaha. Thanks for coming in.
Glad to be here.
You have a bill that is about to get a public hearing next week that has important implications for the long-term water uses in the state.
Right.
And I want to ask you about that, but before I do, you're a city kid, and this is a subject that's most often dominated by rural folks because water is so important for agriculture. Why are you in wading into this subject, as it were, and why should Nebraskans in general care about this subject?
Well, first of all, I get asked that question a lot. What's an Omaha guy weighing in on a question that's primarily about groundwater use and irrigation and the aquifer and that natural resource? And last year I was invited out by Senator Christensen to take a tour of the Republican River Valley. And I met with a bunch of people that talked about the concerns they have for the depletion of the aquifer, primarily in the Republican River Valley, the difficulties in allocating among groundwater users and surface water users that natural resource, and it's a fascinating subject.
It is. Does it have implications for the rest of the state, do you think?
I think it does. Last year or 2 years ago during the drought, Lincoln was essentially rationing water, right? They wouldn't let people water their lawns, which is, of course, is not a big sacrifice. But at some point, those of us on the eastern side of the state who rely on the Platte River for water, and we do in Omaha and in Lincoln, have a concern or have a stake in the management of water, whether it's in the rivers or in the aquifer.
And you said the Platte, and obviously that's where the two cities get part of their water from, or
right.
Lincoln, all
our,
of it.
Our wells are.
But the Republican, is that an isolated problem, or is that do you see this as typical of the state?
The Republican, in my estimation, is unique because it has a compact with Kansas. And so the struggle in the Republican in terms of balancing all the interests involve groundwater, surface water, and then making sure we have enough water that passes through the state and gets down to Kansas to be in compliance with the compact. And with a number of people irrigating and the need to get water down to Kansas for the compact makes it a significant challenge to meet all the needs in the basin and not overuse the resource.
Now, it looks like even though Nebraska used more water than it was supposed to in the mid-2000s, that problem arguably has been addressed now. There are projects to take water that used to be used for irrigation and pump it towards the river and towards Kansas. Doesn't that solve the problem?
There are two problems down in the Republican River Valley, if we just focus on that for a second. One is, what are we doing with the resource? Are we using the water, the groundwater, in a sustainable way, where the amount that we're using equals the resource year in and year out? And when we start using more water than we have, than we can recharge in the aquifer or put back in there from year to year, then you start to deplete the resource, and that's happening. If you look at what's happening, particularly in the upper Republican, the water table is going down because they're using more water year in and year out than the rivers are able to recharge or put back into the ground. And that's one problem. Using, pumping water from, it's called the NCORP project, pumping water from one basin out of the ground, putting it into a conduit or into a stream, and sending it down to Kansas is an entirely different issue. They're related, but the fact that we can make get enough water down to Kansas to meet the compact doesn't mean we're not depleting the resource in the basin.
So what would your legislation do to address this problem?
First of all, we've had a hearing on it when we introduced LB 1074 probably a month ago. And since then, we've been working with some of the interested parties to develop an amendment. So next week we're going to have a hearing on an amendment, and the amendment would become the bill. And essentially what it says is going forward, maybe back up, the water is managed in this state through the Department of Natural Resources and locally by the NRDs.
Right. The DNR does the surface water and the NRDs do the groundwater.
Yeah, and they're supposed to be sort of the overarching policy enforcers, but they leave it to the NRDs to regulate inside the basin, you know, the local control piece of it. And what 1074 does or would do is say, going forward, we're going to have a basin-wide plan for every river. So each river must develop a basin-wide plan, and that's done where all the people that have a stake, like the cities and the power utilities and groundwater and surface water, are all at the table, and they develop a basin-wide plan. And then the integrated management plans for each of those subgroups or the NRDs will be developed consistent with that, and they have to get to sustainable within 30 years. That sounds like a long time out, but there needs to be time for a large ship to turn around, and that's really what we're doing with the bill.
And then you've got a hammer at the end of it. What happens if they don't make it in 30 years?
Well, what's required is the basin-wide plan has to have measurable objectives, intermediate objectives, so that you can see that we're on our way with the policy changes to sustainable within 30 years. And if they're not, then we essentially take local control away and turn it over to DNR.
To the state?
Yes.
And would you take away the taxing authority as well? I mean, NRDs levy property taxes, and the state doesn't. So is this property tax relief?
I would expect at some point they're going to have some cooperation. If we get to 30 years and a basin is not sustainable, what would happen is the regulation would come from Lincoln. They would say, whether it's putting stays on use or setting the allocations, which is more likely to be the case, where they say, okay, instead of getting 12 inches like you've been getting before, we'll ratchet it back to a place so that we're on course to be sustainable.
Is it overkill to apply this statewide if your goal is to address a particular problem in the Republic?
I don't think so, because the Groundwater Management Act doesn't do a good job of requiring that the basins be sustainable right now. They require that they have a plan, and if your plan is to equitably share in the depletion of the aquifer, that may be a plan, and everybody might agree to it, but it doesn't mean it's sustainable. And what changes with this is a state policy that says we are going to have every river basin in a place that's sustainable.
And how do
so
you,
that we preserve the aquifer.
And how do you define sustainable?
That's where the uses and the supply are in balance.
Okay. This proposal of yours surfaces at a time when there's about $31 million worth of water projects that are sort of moving through the system.
Right.
The Appropriations Committee has recommended them. The legislature's given first round approval. Is there a connection? If you don't get your bill, are you going to try to hold up that money flow?
Well, I don't think I have to, but I have a concern, and I've expressed this to folks on the Natural Resources Committee, that the solution can't come from the state writing checks year in and year out to folks and to the NRDs, essentially, and that something has to be done on the regulatory side, too, which is at some point it's fair because of the importance of agriculture and irrigation to agriculture in our economy. That the state makes some contribution to having sustainable practices. And if that involves water projects or perhaps using some of the money to buy out some of the irrigators and send them back to dryland farming so that we are using less water overall in a basin, that's appropriate. But at some point we need to have a policy in place that doesn't encourage or allow overuse.
Well, you're in your last year in the legislature because of term limits. Can't folks who oppose your proposal just outweigh you and the legislature will give $31 million to water projects and you'll be gone? And
well, I will say that I probably would have a problem with $31 million in water projects if we can't move a bill that calls for sustainability statewide within 30 years. Yeah, I'd have a problem with spending more money, because I think it's, and I believe me, I think that Senator Carlson, who chairs the Natural Resources Committee, and the members of that committee recognize that we need to do something from my end of it, as well as bring some resources. So I expect that there'll be some people that have a concern because they don't want to be told to, that there's going to be regulation on the use of groundwater. But at some point, we have to do, from a regulatory point of view, what needs to be done in order to be sustainable. If you look up and down, the aquifer extends from Nebraska down to Texas. And when you look at what's happened in Texas and in Kansas and in Oklahoma with an aquifer, they've just used it till the water table is nearly unreachable. And we can see what's happened in other states that didn't manage this resource well. I think Senator Carlson appreciates that. And what we're trying to do is come at this from two different approaches. One is to have water projects, which that funding in the appropriations bill is intended to address, and the other is to have some regulation that brings us to a sustainable place, so we don't end up like Texas, where there was an aquifer under the ground and it's all gone.
So you're the bad cop and he's the good cop.
Well, I don't know if that's how I'd describe it, but you know what, I'm impressed that Senator Carlson has a commitment to sustainability. His task force went around the state and learned about the importance of the water, the need for certain water projects, and overall the importance of preserving this resource for generations to come.
Okay, well, the hearing on your bill is next Tuesday, so yes, we'll be watching that. Thanks again for coming in.
My pleasure.
This is Capital Conversations. You can see us on the web at netnebraska.org/news. We'll have another discussion next week and hope to see you then.